Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Let's wait for a couple of minutes and then we'll start, okay? And am I visible too?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. We'll start in a couple of minutes, okay? So. Okay, just give me a quick minute, guys. Okay, I'm not able to share my screen. So let me quickly check with Rahul, sir. Okay, one second. Okay. Okay, I hope you guys can hear me and see me as well. Everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Yes, sir. So, the thing is that, you know, I have to share my screen, which I'm not able to do currently. So, someone is working in the background to sort that out. Meanwhile, a question. So, how many of you have faced this question that what should I go for in the beginning? Should I go for speed? Should I, try to meet my, when I'm starting to write my answers, should I go for speed or should I go for, having the best content possible? Okay. Or, should I, go for having good presentations? I'll explain you what is that. So, do you guys, when you start writing your answer, do you feel that you don't have any content? What to write? I don't have anything. Or, you are having to refer to some books and all, which you should not do, but you are having to because you don't have content. And still you are not satisfied ki my answer could have been better. Is that the case?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So, I would want you guys to respond, because, I don't know, in some classes, people just put it in the chat and the teacher is able to see everything. But for me, I'm not very tech savvy. So, it will be better, if people respond by voice. You can consider me that Australopithecus, which, needs the sound, to understand there is a predator. So that's why language evolved. So you can think of me as that Australopithecus who cannot look beyond the grass. I'm too short, cannot look over the grass. So, I would need voice from you guys. So yes, content, you guys face this problem when writing answers that I'm not having enough content, or, when trying to do too good on content, you take too much time. That happens.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Fine. So today we'll start with that discussion and then we'll go into, some, five questions of the previous year. So it's been a long day, so I'm sipping coffee while talking. So I hope you guys will not mind.
No, sir.
Okay. All right. So this dilemma that we all have, speed or content or presentation. Let me see if you guys can see my screen. Can you guys see my screen, all of you?
Yes, sir.
No. Okay, let me just try once again to share once again.
Yes, sir.
Now you should be able to see.
Yes,
okay?
Sir.
All right. So, speed or content or presentation. So what, you should understand, speed, content, but what is presentation? That is also the third dimension of your answers and a very, very important dimension, especially given the fact that, the anthropology syllabus is such that most of the students, I have talked about this again and again, that most of the students, may have the same answers, very similar answers, having very similar examples, having very similar, conclusion and stuff also. So presentation is what will give the first impression to the teacher. So when the teacher looks at the answer sheet, before he's even read, even before even he or she has read even one line of your answer, the first thing will be the presentation that will fall into the eyes. So what is the presentation? So suppose if I am writing an answer, suppose the question is, say, society and culture, or the question is, say, differentiate between culture and civilization. So culture versus civilization, there is a question. Okay, so I start the answer first, first thing, anthropology is you have to define. So you will define culture, you will define civilization. So you will start somewhere here, that culture is this, the line goes like this, and then that para is over, right? Now you want to define civilization after that, so you start from here and you define civilization. Now, culture versus civilization. So, similarities. The heading is similarities. This is the heading. You underline the heading. You start somewhere from here, like this. And if suppose there is a subheading under this, suppose there is a subheading here, then the next line starts from here. So they keep shifting to the right. And when you again come to something that is at the same level as similarities, like differences, so differences will be here. So am I able to, explain you that you keep on shifting, it will be clear cut that this is a heading. These things are under this heading. And there's a subheading that is to the right of this. So it is under this. And then there are points here. And you again, when you go here, it means that this part is over and something that is at the same level, similarities is going to start here. Differences. Getting what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You know, making your answer look like, you know, a nice presentation, like you have in the books. It should not be like this, you know. You start from here. Suddenly, you know, you have something from here, and then you have something from here. You have something from here. This suppose that you are giving a heading, culture, and under the heading, here is the heading, and you are writing from here. No. Culture. Suppose this is your answer sheet. This is your heading, culture. Your paragraph should be like this. Then again, culture done. Civilization. There is a subheading under civilization. So you give the heading here, and then the lines will be like this. Again, this is done. You are coming back to this level again. Society. So alignment of the answer. What I mean to say is alignment of the answer. It should, you know, be clearly understood that this is the heading, and these points are under that heading. This is the heading. These points are under that heading, and these are under this. You know, uske bhi niche. And then once this is done, again you are going back to the main headings. Alignment of the answer, one thing. Second thing will be, all of you make diagrams, will make diagrams, and some are making excellent diagrams, better than the books. Like Sai Kiran is making diagrams that are better than the books. Although I keep saying that if it is taking a lot of time, you know, think about it. You should not, you know, put too much time into it, because a simple diagram can also serve the purpose. But Sai Kiran is also shading, you know, so it is like, you know, nice. It's giving, looking very good, but I'm sure it's taking time. How much time is it taking, Sai? Is it Sai or is it Kiran? I mean, what should I call you when someone addresses?
Both are fine, sir.
Both are fine, yeah. So how much time is it taking right now?
It's taking for 10 marks question. It's taking 10 minutes, sir. Three minutes more.
Okay. If you are able to do that in 10 minutes, that is unbelievable, because the quality of diagrams you have made and the number of points you are giving, if you are able to do a 10 marker in 10 minutes, you have to just improve by 3 minutes. With a lot of practice, you can easily come to 7 minutes. So, I mean, I don't know.
Initially, it took 15 minutes, sir, before 1 year. But now it is possibly taking 10 minutes.
Possibly, we are looking at a 320 plus guy in our class. Okay, so maybe 330, 340 also, you never know. So keep it up. And as you said, you know that you need to work on the other parts apart from physical anthropology. You have to have equal, you know, kind of hold on all of them, not just one part. Yeah. So this is presentation. Then suppose a diagram, you know, suppose you make a skull diagram. So I have already talked about this earlier. Let me just 1 second. Yeah, so you have made a diagram. Suppose, you know, you have made a diagram of, say, the tribes that are located, the pastoral tribes. I keep on giving their examples. There are other examples also. For example, you know, endangered languages. So if you are making an India map, you know, even for the tribes, it is always advisable to, this is Nepal, this is Sikkim, Bhutan, Northeast. This is our very fast developing neighbor, Bangladesh. This is Northeast. And this is Western part, Peninsula, like this. Okay. How many seconds it took? Maybe 10 seconds, less than that. So this is India map. Now, labeling. The labeling should not be like, you know, so this labeling coming from all sides. No, it should not be like that. You know, labeling from all, scattered in all directions. You should always try to have an alignment in this also. So for example, so here is Sirmauri. Here is the language Toto. You know, here, so you have some Ruga. These are some languages that are endangered. So labeling. Look at the thing. No, you mentioned this is Sirmauri, this is Ruga, this is put, and then the diagram. You don't need to draw this with a pencil and a scale. You can by hand only put the diagram inside the box. Put here figure. Figure is about endangered languages. Done. This is much better than a diagram, you know, just popping up anywhere in the answer, you know, and without any boundary and all. Because a lot of times what happens, you have made a diagram and your labeling is getting mixed with what you have written in the answers body, that is getting mixed with the labeling. That should not happen. It should be inside a box. Some of you do very well, you know, by underlining the things. Some of you are also doing putting the words in boxes. Suppose you have talked about Edward Tyler and you put like this. Putting in boxes is also a very good practice. You know, it's more, you know, visible than the underlining. Now, one more thing is about the diagrams. Don't, when you start an answer, you know, you look at the question and see, oh my God, yes, this is what I wanted. I have a diagram for this question and that's what I'm going to do. Your diagram should not be at the beginning or at the end. You make a diagram and then write, or you write and then make a diagram. No, diagram should be between the answer, somewhere in between the answer. Okay, so this is called presentation. So presentation is extremely important. So whether you should, you know, day one of answer writing, whether you should, you know, start putting pressure on your presentation bit, or whether you should go for content, which is absolutely knowledge, which is, you know, and then whether you go for speed. So all three are important. Speed, content, presentation. Speed, content, presentation. Anyone who has all the three is definitely going to be the best scorer. Okay. You may have a lot of speed, but you don't have knowledge. What will you do with the speed? You have all the knowledge, but you cannot express it within the time. What will you do? You have all the knowledge, but it's written so badly that the examiner is not interested into checking your answers. So all three are important: presentation, content, and speed. And all three will come with practice, with patience. I keep telling this to so many guys from day one, do not take the headache of at least this part, content. Content is the most important part, but this is the part which you should be more relaxed about. You will not have content on day one. It is humanly impossible to have content on day one when you are writing. Until and unless, you know, you were a professor of anthropology somewhere and suddenly you think that you should give UPSC. That is a different thing. Otherwise, you will not have the content on day one of answer writing. If you have finished the syllabus revised 3-4 times, still you don't have content, that's a worry. You should worry if you have finished the syllabus revised 3 times and you are not getting content. But most of you have not done that. So don't worry about content. For example, if the question comes about, say, religion. Everyone is able to hear me and see me?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
everyone,
sir.
Everyone is able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Suppose the question comes about religion. Tell me, where is religion mentioned in the syllabus? Anyone?
Under sociocultural.
Yes, very good. Can you roughly name the what unit is it?
Unit 5, sir.
You said that unit 5?
Nisha, sir.
Excellent, Nisha. Very good. Now, Nisha, tell me, where else do you have religion?
Sir, tribal socio-cultural condition, maybe we have religion.
Very good.
Impact
where
of
else,
religion.
Where else do we have religion?
In theories.
Whose theory?
The contribution of Dalem.
Contribution of?
Dalem.
Sorry, I'm not getting the name. Tyler. E.B. Tyler.
Yes, sir. E.B. Tyler.
Why? What Tyler told about religion?
It's origin, sir.
Kaun bol raha, Nisha?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So,
sir, Srinivas also.
Yes, Srinivas. Srinivas ka religion ke baare mein, tell me something. What is Srinivas?
Sir, nature, man, spirit, and one thing is that of ki holy places mein jaane se jo diffusion hota hai, wo sab
is that Srinivas?
Nature, man, spirit is Srinivas, I guess. As far as I remember.
I guess it's LP Vidyarthi.
Oh, sorry.
Both the concepts are Vidyarthi, okay?
Yes.
Very careful. Vidyarthi. So religion, okay. Now, Tyler, anyone else who's talked about religion? Nisha, I'm giving you a hint. It is in theories only. Two more people.
It's someone who has given a magic. So
no, you cannot say someone. Is it who is?
Is
Nisha.
Yes, yeah. Durkheim also talked about religion.
Durkheim, yeah. Fraser, one more person.
Morgan
also talked about religion.
It's a cultural materialistic.
Who said that cultural materialism? Very much, yes. Marvin Harris. And who said that religion is, you know, to give peace and security to ourselves? We are scared. You know, for mental peace, we follow religion. Malinowski.
Yes,
who was the people he was studying here? There?
Trobriand Islanders.
Fantastic. Yes. So tell me, religion, exactly the word religion in the syllabus is mentioned on Unit 5. Yes, now you read Unit 5. You take out the previous year's question paper and you start answering. And you think that you are not getting enough content. It's not possible. Religion is scattered throughout the syllabus. Okay. Similarly, if the question comes about, you know, say Franz Boas. Franz Boas is, I feel that he should be called the father of anthropology. Although he is not called father of anthropology, I believe he should be. His contributions are so immense. He's contributed in blood group studies. He's contributed in race study, that is physical anthropology. He's contributed is, you know, in art and culture. He's contributed in socio-cultural anthropology, which is, you know, cultural relativism. You know, he has given his theory of historical particularism. He has talked about field studies, how to do it, how not to do it. He has talked about, you know, so many things. Okay. And you can simply not just read, you know, Franz Boas mentioned chapter, you know, historical particularism, Franz Boas. Just reading that, you cannot answer a question on Franz Boas. So it is physically or, you know, humanly impossible to have all the content at your fingertip when writing your first answer. So do not take unnecessary stress of not having good content if you have not finished the syllabus and revised 2 times. If you have done that and still not getting content, you should be worried. Otherwise, don't worry. Just write today. Whatever you have read about religion, write that. Whatever you know about that, write that. No issues. You'll keep on writing. And 2 months later, you'll realize that, you know, I can add this, this, and this also. So your answer will be better. Another 1 month later, you know, you'll have finished the syllabus and you'll see, okay, I can add even this and this. And you will also have some diagrams. You'll have some more examples. Okay? So once you are nearing the finishing of the syllabus, gradually as you cover the syllabus, your content keeps on developing. So do not run after content from day one. So one of the things gone, content. And presentation. Yes, presentation and speed. This is what you should try to pursue from day one. You cannot keep all the three for later. Ki sara tino ek saath karenge. Aisa nahi hoga. That will not happen. Keep the content for later. It will keep on coming as you read the syllabus. But at least make the habit of, you know, meeting the time and present writing in a proper presentable way. Once you make that habit, even if your content increases, you know, you'll have the habit and you will be able to still manage in the time. Again, your content increases, you still will be able to manage in time. So you have the habit of, you know, being the slave of the clock. That's what you have to be. If you are the slave of the clock, I have to meet in 7 minutes, 10 minutes. Put that thing inside your brain from the day one. I have to write, you know, proper conclusion and introduction, body conclusion with proper alignment and diagrams in the boxes, labeling in proper way. Put that habit in yourself. Whatever content you have, present it like that. Whatever content you have, finish in time. So time and presentation from day one, content will come.
May I ask a doubt?
Yeah.
Sir, regarding time management, practically in the exam, digital clocks are not allowed. And we have to use that analytical one.
Yes, yes.
So, sir, analog, then how to count, like we are giving 7 minutes or 5 minutes. Like 5 minutes is also okay.
Okay,
but
yeah.
Giving 7 minutes or 8 minutes.
5 minutes is too less. You know, 5 minutes may you not be able to answer, finish an answer until you are writing towards the end when you are too fast.
Yes,
sir. What I will tell you, for GS, again, 5 minutes, 7 minutes, this, you know, breakup is difficult. So make a roundabout breakup for you. I have 20 questions to answer in GS. Some are 15 markers, some are 10 markers. If I divide by 3 hours, it comes to 7 hours per question. 7 hours per question will make 21 questions. Yahan tak clear? Understood till here? Okay.
Yes,
understood?
Sir.
Now, some of you start with question number 11, which is 15 marker. Some of you write the 15 marker first. So after 1 hour, I will say, you know, at the end of 30 minutes only, just look at the clock, 30 minutes. How many have I done? if I have done 3 and I'm doing even the 10 marker, still it is fine. If I have done 2, I'm doing the 15 marker, still it is fine. First hour will take some time. In the first hour, you will not be able to write 7. Not possible. First hour mein thoda sa kam hoga. First hour mein, you know, whether you write 15 marker or 10 marker, you will have a few, thoda sa lag rahega. You will have at least 6 or 5 like that finished. You know, it will be there. And then you see, okay, 1 hour gone, 5 questions gone. I have 15 questions, 2 hour. I have to finish 7.5, at least 8 in the next hour. So have hourly target for GS and push yourself from the first answer itself. For optional. For optional, you have to answer 5 questions. Each question is of 50 marks. Okay, if you'll see, out of 8, you have to answer 5 questions and every question is of 50 marks. Okay, so you have to finish every 50 mark question, that is a question with parts A, B, C. Every question has to be finished in 35 minutes. Okay, so when you start writing, you look at the question paper. Okay, I have this question of 50 marks. It has subparts. One is a 20 marker, one is a 15 marker, one is a 15 marker. I have to finish in 35 minutes. So at least, you know, I'll have to finish at least 15 minutes. May 20 marker has to be over, and the remaining 20 minutes may I'll do 15 markers, 10 minutes. Like that, you can make a rough breakup of, you know, the hour. Am I clear? Was it understood, or I mean, should I explain further?
Yes, sir, clear.
Yeah. So, you know, make a breakup. You know, don't go by, you know, key, okay, 7 minutes, 14 minutes, 21 minutes. Not like that. Look at the hour. Okay, 3 hours. Every hour may 7 questions. For GS, for optional, every 50 marker section in 35 minutes. That make a breakup like that. And what kind of breakup works for you? Whether starting with 15 marker works for you in GS, what works, what doesn't work, you can do that experiment and learn in the test series. You cannot do that, you know, that in the exam hall. Okay, so now we'll begin.
So okay? For yeah. 50 marker question, so sir, pehle ghante mein bhi matlab hum aise hi expect karke chale ki 35 minute mein hum 50 markers ka kar rahe hain.
Yes, bilkul. Give yourself target of 35 minutes for the 50 marker. That is the target. But what I said was, possibly in the first hour, you take some time to gather speed. Possibly when you just start writing, there is some, you know, inertia starting with the first answer. You start thinking. So ideally what will happen, you know, for most of the people, the speed will be a little slower in the first hour. So, you know, you keep yourself to give the goal of 35 minutes, may 50 mark, you know, 50 marks khatam ho jana chahiye like that. But maybe by the time you have finished your first 50 mark section, it will be not 35 minutes, but 45 minutes. Maybe even 50 minutes. Okay. So just look at that. Okay. So I have exceeded my first answer ka quota by 15 minutes. I have to make up in other questions and then push yourself and increase the speed. You know, you have to keep, you know, you have to break the exam in several parts, you know, and then you know, tackle it. If you just keep writing, enjoy writing and see, 15 minutes left. That will not work. You have to break exam in small parts and tackle them.
So,
divide and rule. Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for addressing the question. So, sir, this we can apply for the full length test. But, sir, like we are starting with the sectional test and all. And usually a sectional test has maximum 5 to 6 questions. It differs like according to the test series.
Yeah.
So, what to do like in that case? How to practice?
So, what we are doing is, you know, when you are writing the sectional test of, say, 5 questions, give yourself some target. That I will finish these 5 questions in 45 minutes. For yourself, you know, I mean, without me telling or anyone telling, you give yourself target that I'll finish this in 45 minutes. Start that habit. Ki 5 question, 45 minutes, I'll finish. Wahan par bhi set a time and try that. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. And don't worry about content. Most of you guys are saying, sir, it could have been better. I missed out that. You know, and referring to the book. Don't do that. You know, don't spoil the habit of referring to the book. What you can do is, at the worst, what you can do is look at the question. Take low question. Okay. Read from the book. But don't write right away. Read from the book. The question can answer. You can read from the book. Keep it aside. Write next day out of memory. Try to recall from memory what you read last day and try to write. Turant, you know, just reading, looking at the book and writing the answer. Never do that. you are cheating yourself if you do that. Theek hai, we'll start. So previous year's questions. Natufian culture, very nice. I will share a word file. Let me see where it is.
Sir, will you share this PDF later, or should we copy it?
What I have, I have not made a model answer for all the 5 questions. I have made some type of, indicative answers for 3-4 questions. I'll share that. Okay. Whatever I have made, I'll share. Don't worry. Okay. Just one second. Diademy, where are you? Wait.
Sir, for people preparing for 2022, what should be our target for optional? Like I'm reading it and it's going to be my first reading right now.
Okay.
So sir, what should I do?
Is this Vinita, who is Priyanshi?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Priyanshi, you are reading for the first time. Okay, so your goal should be the thing is that, no one has ever passed the exam by reading the book once. It has to be revised multiple times. So your goal should be, are you appearing in 2022?
Yes, sir.
Much time is not left, but still we have November to almost is gone. December, January. You have to finish it by February.
First reading?
Definitely first reading. You cannot, if you try to revise also in that 3 months, then what will happen is the quality of studying will be very poor. You'll just rush. You have to understand also. So at least 3 months you have to give for first reading. And tell me, how is your, how confident are you with your GS part? Your prelims.
Sir, I'm also preparing for GS parallelly.
Okay.
So it's not so much confident, I cannot say.
Yeah. So some adjustment has to be done. So ek cheez yaad rakhna, that it is always advisable to have finished your optional before prelims, but it's not a hard and fast rule that anyone who has not, finished, anyone who has not finished, this before prelims has not cleared the exam. Aisa nahi hota hai. Some lot of people have finished part of it before the prelims, part after the prelims. That also happens. So don't get demotivated if you are not able to finish in this 3 months, because you have to also think about your prelims. Now, someone who is very confident about prelims, he can say that fine, I can just take the last 45 days also, and that will do before prelims. And someone might need 4 months also before prelims. So you decide how many months before prelims you need to focus only on prelims. If you need, say February also, February, March, April, May, you need 4 months. So take February also for prelims, and just keep December, January for your anthropology, and try to finish as much as possible in that. If the entire thing is not finished, nothing to worry. Not to worry at all. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You can, some people have also, finished it after some part of it after prelims and got even marks like 360. So possible. Okay. Fine. Now we quickly go into the question answers. So today I have taken up questions that came in 2020. Now, for some of you here, anyone here who is appearing for 2021? Anyone here appearing for 2021 means? No one. If you are typing in chat, I will not be able to. Okay, someone has asked. Yeah. JJ. Yeah. So JJ, this workshop is definitely for 2021 also. Why not? Because I'm talking about, the ways to write answer. Now, you may think, those who are appearing in 2021 may think, if we are talking about 2021, why is sir discussing 2020 questions? Jo 20 mein aa gaya, what has come in 20 will not come in 21. If that is what you are thinking, revise that thinking. UPSC is not a state PCS exam where, what has come last year will not come this year. I remember 2019, they asked about Victor Turner. 2020 also, they asked about Victor Turner. I will not be surprised if in 2021 also they asked about Victor Turner, a different concept of Turner. Okay, so 2020 questions also we'll discuss, because 2020 questions will not come in 21, not necessary. And they will not exactly ask Natufian culture. Maybe they will ask some other culture. Maybe they will ask Dholavira culture. So how to present that answer under what headings, that you can see from here, right? 21 guys. Okay. So the question was regarding Natufian culture. How many of you were aware regarding Natufian culture before looking at the question paper? If in case you have seen the question paper, some of you may not have seen the question paper. How many of you have gone through the question paper? I need your names. You can speak
up. I have gone through the question paper of previous 5 years.
Previous 5 years. Okay. Anyone else was gone through the papers?
Yes, sir. I have gone.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So Natufian culture. Natufian culture is something, you know, that surprised many of you. You know, but you should not be surprised if questions like these come, because this is very much part of syllabus. Your Neolithic, Mesolithic, these are part of syllabus. And if they ask about any specific culture, very much part of syllabus. Now you will be thinking, how can we cover this? If they just pick up one culture's name and give it like that in the exam, we are reading what is Neolithic, what is Mesolithic, what is Paleolithic, now what is Megalithic. If they just pick up one site's name and talk about and write 10 marker about it, how can we do that? Thinking of anyone worried about that?
Yes, sir.
No, okay. Sir.
Yes, Suraj, why not worried?
Sir, what I have thought about, I was seeing the through the paper, then I figured it out. Mm-hmm. If we know a particular, like if we are having the details about Mesolithic or Paleolithic,
yes,
anything, we can yes. use it. If we don't know anything, exactly. then we can use it actually the basic premises of the what we know and mm-hmm. we supplement it to the narrative.
Okay.
But the fact is that, sir, how we come yeah. to know that which culture is part of
exactly
yeah.
So a lot of people, you know, would have tried that trick, Suraj, you know, if they would have known. But I am afraid a lot of people did not know Natufian is part of which, Mesolithic or Neolithic.
Yes, that's what
so
I
if you know, you can, you know, write the general features of Mesolithic mm-hmm. if you know. But if you don't know what, so you should not be worried, you know, because if any specific culture is picked up, it will be picked up only if it is really, really important. So when covering the syllabus, you will see certain sites are very important. Like Natufian culture is extremely important because agriculture started there. Okay. It is the, you know, cradle from where agriculture started. So this culture has always been important. They may ask about Nevasa, N-E-V-A-S-A, Nevasa in India. It is also extremely important, and it can come like a 10 marker. It is a single site, but it can come because it is important, because before Nevasan culture was, you know, discovered, Indian archaeology had nothing for Mesolithic. We had, you know, old Stone Age and new Stone Age. India had no site for, you know, Middle Paleolithic. And it was considered that India mein middle Paleolithic stage was not there only. But then it was discovered. Bhimbetka, extremely, extremely important, not only for your anthropology, but also for your GS paper one, mains mein.
Brilliant.
Bhimbetka. So Bhimbetka, these kind of sites which are important for something. Bhimbetka is known for the paintings. And Bhimbetka ke saath mein Adamgarh also you should read. Okay. UP. Then Nevasa. Then, you know, Dholavira. Which culture does Dholavira belong to?
Harappan.
Harappan culture. And why is it so important?
UNESCO 39.
It became the UNESCO heritage site. Yes. So you should also, I would also suggest you also do some reading about Rakhigarhi.
Rakhigarhi, yes.
And Banavali. Because these two are the sites that are competing with the Pakistani sites of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. Because, you know, we had this bad feeling, you know, that this was part of India and it became a separate country and we lost something that could be called the home of Indus Valley civilization. So we started digging here in Haryana and we found out some sites that are bigger in size than Mohenjo-daro. Okay. So you should know about these two, Rakhigarhi and Banavali in Haryana. One more site you should know about is in Uttar Pradesh, the site's names. Sanauli is important, definitely important. There's something else, you know.
Sir, anyone else? Bhogar, Baghor 2.
No, Baghor, no, Baghor. Chupani Mando. No.
Sarai Nahar Rai
is also important. Yeah, these are important, but I'm looking at something else. I'm not getting the name.
Mahananda Damda something.
No. That site what I'm talking about. So as of now, if I tell you which is the site which has the earliest example of agriculture in the subcontinent, what is the site?
It's just a second, sir. I have just studied today itself.
Mehrgarh?
Mehrgarh, who said that?
That's Pakistan, sir.
Yeah, Mehrgarh is in Pakistan. I said subcontinent. Okay. Suraj. So Mehrgarh has been, you know, always we keep on talking about Mehrgarh. So again, a pain for us in the heart that, you know, it is not part of India. So we have found out a site in Uttar Pradesh that is older than, maybe older than Mehrgarh, or at least of the same antiquity. And it has a lot of differences from Mehrgarh. Mehrgarh was known only for, you know, wheat and, you know, barley. And this site is the earliest example of rice cultivation in the subcontinent around same time, 7000 BC. I'm not able to recollect the name of the site.
So one more is that Lake Khai and Borgahi Khor. This both are in UP either.
Recently in news for some reason? Lekhai. No. So Lekhai, yeah, I know that. Lekhai. But you cannot go about reading all the, so yes, why, yes. Choose wisely. The ones that are some, you know, biggest or first in something. So like Natufian culture, first in agriculture. Mehrgarh, first in agriculture in the subcontinent. Dholavira, you know, it is in UNESCO site. So pick some sites like that, which are really, really significant, massively important, and do them. Okay, fine.
Dholavira for water harvesting and
water harvesting. Yeah. And it, yeah, definitely. But it became, you know, UNESCO heritage site recently.
Yes.
So
yes.
That makes it extremely important. Okay. Fine. Now, so Natufian culture was there. A lot of you would have been shocked. So I have written kind of a model answer for Natufian culture. Now, if you see my answer, the answer is quite lengthy. I have written an answer that will be, you know, I'll also add a diagram. So it will be easily an answer of 20 marker. But the question was a 10 marker. Why I have done that? UPSC has this habit of, you know, asking the same topic in different years. Sometimes the same topics come from 10 marks, sometimes 15 marks, sometimes 20 marks. So if you have a 20 marker ka information ready, you can, you know, card chart ki, you can make it shorter for 10 marks. So for that reason, I have, you know, put all the significant information regarding Natufian culture and made it like a 20 marker. So everyone can see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, yes, sir.
So normally, you know, for any of the sites, we, you know, when it was excavated, who was the discoverer, those kind of things are important. So Dorothy Garrett, 1930s, you know, she excavated the site and she also named the site as the Natufian culture. Okay? And where it was found, you know, Shukba Cave in Wadi An-Natuf, in a town that is in the Judean Mountains. Can you tell me, anyone, where is it located? If I tell you present geography, which country?
Jerusalem, Israel.
Israel. Okay, yes, so Israel and Palestine. So this thing is located in today's Israel and Palestine. And the Natufian communities may be the ancestors of the builders of the first Neolithic settlements. So first Neolithic settlements where people settled down, you know, from hunting, gathering, they settled down as agriculturists. This may be the first of them. So I've given some unique features of Natufian culture. What is unique about them? The culture, you know, even before introduction, even before people started doing agriculture, it's very important to understand this. So we say that, you know, people settle down when they do agriculture, when agriculture starts. This place, people became almost semi-sedentary or sedentary. People started staying at one place even before agriculture had started. Even before agriculture, people settled down at one place. Anyone knows the reason?
I guess availability of fresh water.
The reason is related to agriculture only. See what happened? The people migrating through that place, you know, they found out that there some wild grasses are growing.
Wild rice and all, yeah.
Wild grasses are growing, and those wild grasses bear some small grains. And they, you know, someone would have, you know, picked up one grain and chewed it, and they found that it seems fine, edible. You know, we can try something with that. And they started using the grains of those wild grasses, and those wild grasses were nothing but the ancestors of today's wheat and barley. They were wild grasses growing wildly, having the seed quality. Seeds will be very small, very tiny, and the seeds very few in numbers. That was the wild variety. Okay, so they started using, you know, they started harvesting and cutting the wild grass and eating it. So without cultivating only, they thought that here we'll stay here because yahan pe, in, you know, in in the year 2-3 times this grass grows, which gives us some, you know, grain to eat. And aspas mein there are also, you know, water bodies and also other animals to hunt, and fishing, all things are there. So because of those wild grasses, people settled there. Okay, so people settled even before they actually started cultivation. And why this cultivation started? There's a theory. The theory is that people were, for many centuries, people settled there before starting agriculture. And for many centuries, they kept on eating those wild grasses, grains. Suddenly, around 9,000 to 10,000 years ago, around 9,000, 10,000 BC, around 10,000 BC. So that is around 12,000 years ago. So the climate, usually what was happening is, what happened, as far as climate is concerned, what happened around 12,000 BC or 12,000 years ago, 10,000 BC?
Ice age started melting, I guess. Yes.
So ice age, it was the end of the ice age. Yes. And what era ended and what era started? You have to know the words. Suraj.
Pleistocene.
Not Palestine. It's Pleistocene. Yes. Pleistocene ended and what started? Holocene. Holocene started. Okay. Pleistocene ended, and these are very important. The entire Pleistocene is where, our ancestors kept on developing, and Holocene is the age that is currently going on. So Pleistocene ended, Holocene began, and the normal trend was that the, glaciers are melting now, things are becoming warmer and moister. All the moisture was trapped in the ice. Now the ice is melting. So more water bodies, more moisture in the air, some rain happening, some ponds and all are filling up, and the climate is becoming warmer because the glaciers are melting. So this was the normal tendency of climate getting warmer and wetter. But suddenly around 10,000 BC, there was around 1,000 year period of cold climate. Suddenly there was a mini ice age. It is called mini ice age, or also called younger dryas. I've written it here. Okay. It is called the younger D-R-Y-A-S, younger dryas, around 10,800 to 9,500 BC. For this 1,000 year, suddenly the climate became colder, and they realized that this grass that grows wildly is not able to survive in this kind of a climate. Okay, so they started protecting it. They started, planting its seeds to grow more of the grass. They started planting the seeds to grow more of the grass, and they started clearing the other bushes that were not required. So they started to clear all the bushes that are not required, make space, and plant the seeds of this grain that they were eating, because they were badly dependent on it and they did not want to lose it to the colder climate. This is how agriculture began. Okay? Got it, guys?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So with that background, we cannot put the entire story in the answer. So, unique features are semi-sedentary, people became sedentary even before agriculture started. There is evidence that suggests that cereals, that is especially rye, was the earliest evidence of cereal cultivation. The world's oldest evidence of bread making, people making bread, chapati, the bread, they used to light up a fire, keep a stone on the fire, on the hot stone they used to make the chapati. Why were they not making it on a tawa?
Sir, Iron Age has not yet been discovered,
so they could have made a tawa of some other metal like bronze.
It can be.
Even Bronze Age had not arrived, Suraj.
Okay.
Yes.
We are still in the Stone Age, okay? It was a new Stone Age. So no metals had been discovered. So they were making the, so you have to imagine like this. If you imagine, you start loving the subject. So they were making those chapatis. I have seen a lot of documentaries. So those images keep floating in my mind. They're making those rough looking, mota, chapatis, thick chapatis.
Sir, which documentary?
I will look for it. I had seen a beautiful documentary that starts from Neolithic and ends around, I think.
Sir, there is one documentary called From Ape to Human.
Ape to Man is a classic which you must watch. You have to watch. But this was a different documentary.
Share it, sir, later.
Yeah, definitely. I will look for it because I have not saved it somewhere. So I'll have to look for it. It is a documentary in three series. Each documentary is around 50 to 60 minutes long. Three parts, so around 3 hours. But extremely enriching. All the way from Neolithic to, Bronze Age to Copper Age, to Copper Age to Bronze Age to Iron Age, and all those things are very nicely covered with a story of some characters. There are some characters in there. So very, very nice. Okay. So first, you know, evidence of bread making and the oldest evidence of beer. You know, this thing, Madeira, it is as old as civilizations. You know, this is as old as civilizations. Drinking is not something new. People have, you know, as soon as people found out a grain, you know, they started making beer. So even today, you know, the beer is made of, you know, barley and all, you know, those who drink, they would know. And this began then itself. They found out barley, and as soon as they found out barley, they started making beer. So first evidence of beer also, you know, it around this time. So these are some unique things. So now look at the headings. These are the kind of headings that you should be putting in all your answers that are regarding any site or regarding any culture, like Paleolithic culture, Mesolithic culture, Neolithic culture, or when a specific culture's name is given, Natufian culture, Nevasa culture, Harappa culture, whatever. So you should have these kind of headings. You should give the period. What was the period? So as per radiocarbon dating, terminal Pleistocene, that is Pleistocene was ending and Holocene was beginning around that time, 12,500 to 9,500 BC is the period. And this period has been split into two parts, 10,800 and 10,800. This splitting is done for this reason. This splitting is done because the first period, can everyone see this, these two periods?
Yes, sir.
The splitting is for a reason. The splitting is because the first period, that is, you know, the 12,000 to 10,800 BC, this is the time when they were, you know, happily getting used to the wild grass. And the later 1000, around 1000 is a time when climate became colder and, you know, they had to protect the grass. And they started protecting and agriculture started. So because of different climates in this period, the period has been broken up into two parts. It is the second part when agriculture actually started. Okay. So I have written this, you know, you can make this point shorter. You know, I have written this so that you can understand what was happening around that time. You can, you know, make this part shorter. The climate is very important for all our answers in archaeology. So climate and its outcome towards the fag end of Pleistocene and the Great Ice Age. And hence the climate was getting warmer and wetter. But according to a theory, this is a theory and it has not been proven yet. According to a theory, there was a sudden setting in of cold and dry climate in the late Natufian period, which is called the Younger Dryas. This period is called Younger Dryas. There are many documentaries on this also. We don't need to go too deep into this Younger Dryas. It will be interesting. This period is interesting because around this time, it was around this time, you know, when after this time. So this Younger Dryas, what happened, you know, 1000 years of cooler period. So I'm digressing from the topic, but this is also very interesting. 1000 years of colder period, again some snow was forming in many parts of the world, and then when again this thing happened and again the snow melted, so the water levels in the oceans rose again. And this is the period when Dwarka, where is it? Bet Dwarka,
Gujarat.
This is the time it got submerged. So some theories say that some urban like structures are found under the sea in Gujarat. Yes. What could have been Dwarka? So this is something really interesting and needs more research, but someone is not, you know, no one is researching. An urban like place around 10,000 BC old, older than Indus Valley civilization. Why are we not researching? So this is a topic for some other day, but you know, you have to think of these things, you know. So Younger Dryas, and this produced sudden drought because the weather became cooler, no clouds are forming, so no rains. You know, sudden drought in the Levant. What is Levant, guys?
So Israel-Palestine region.
The same region, okay? The same region is called Levant also, okay? And that's why, you know, ISIS, the terrorists, there's another name for ISIS.
Al-Qaeda.
No.
Not Al-Qaeda.
Different, man. They're different, yeah. Okay, Al-Qaeda, and there are two more names I can think of for ISIS.
ISIS-K.
ISISK is a branch of ISIS, you can say. Okay, the parent organization, ISIS, has two names. One is the local language, they call it Daesh. In the local language, the people of Iraq and Syria don't call it IS, Islamic State. They call it the Daesh. Okay. And it's ISIS, another name is ISIL. Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. The same word, Levant. Okay?
Sir, what's explained in this figure. I joined 5 minutes late.
Actually not about religion. This figure is actually, you know, I was saying how to draw diagrams, okay. The presentation part. So you see the diagram is here. It's put inside a box. Here you have mentioned what is the figure about. Okay, like a book, the way diagrams are mentioned in the book. And then the labeling is like this. See, all at one place, all at one level. Okay, this thing. You see that? Okay. That is what I was talking about. So making the diagrams more presentable. Mm-hmm. And religion thing was, you know, something that is not actually relevant. It was something else.
Okay, sir.
Okay. All right. So that place is also called Levant, that Middle East part. Okay. So now going back. So it was becoming a drought-like condition, and the wild cereals that the people had become so dependent on, the people started protecting it, you know, by clearing the scrub and planting the seeds of the wild grain. This is the beginning of agriculture, as I said earlier. Okay. Subsistence means what was the economic activity. So for us, economic activities, your factories and, you know, airlines and all those things, you know, the BPO industry and Ambani and Adani. But for that period, subsistence means how we are getting food. You know, whatever we are doing today, all the economic activities are for getting food. So what we do for getting food is subsistence. So today, subsistence may be, you know, the industries and everything. But for these kind of cultures, subsistence will be hunting, gathering, where they're doing agriculture. This is called subsistence, how they were subsisting. So their subsistence was mainly wild cereals. Okay, they used to exploit. Later they wanted, you know, they went into agriculture. They also hunted animals like gazelles. And in the second part of Natufian culture, they started agriculture. I already discussed that. What is material culture? Material culture is, you know, the kind of tools and stuff they use. So they used microliths. Anyone can throw some light on what are microliths?
Smaller stone tool and more refined.
Very small tools.
Tools and kind of flakes.
Yes.
Very small and
microliths. Very small. Started hunting birds
now,
also.
Suraj, I think we had discussed this right earlier.
Yes.
Okay, let me ask others in that case. So microliths are characteristic of which archaeological period? When do microliths appear?
Mesolithic.
Okay, who was the first one to say Mesolithic? Okay, fine. So, ठीक है आप ही बता दो. Mesolithic period में microliths suddenly appear. Why? Why do they appear?
Because the climate got warmer, so the small birds were there. They needed smaller.
Good. Yes. So, you know, you have to think, you know, everything is related to climate. This is called climate determinism. Climate determines. So right now it doesn't happen. Right now we do not let the climate determine. The climate is very hot in Saudi Arabia, but I can still have, you know, ice hockey because I have the money to, you know, create ice there. But
artificial
back then,
rain.
Yeah, back then, you know, people were dependent badly on environment. Environment determined everything. So environment changed from Paleolithic to Mesolithic. Environment changed, the type of flora, fauna, the animals changed. Now there were no big, you know, woolly rhino and woolly mammoth to hunt. They were small birds and fishes. So they could not run around with a 4 kg, you know, 4 kilo ka, you know, hand axe leke, they are chasing a bird. Not possible. They will not get, you know, they cannot kill a fish in the water with a, you know, 4 kg ka hand axe or a chopper and chopping tool. So they needed small tools. So they made those small tools. They fitted, you know, at the end of the wood, and they made like bows and arrows and harpoon and all those things to hunt small, you know, animals. So climate made people change their tools from big tools to small tools. So microlith tools, you know, are made in different shapes, lunates, trapezes, and triangles. So basically lunate is, you know, like a half circle, you know, trapeze is like, you know, a trapezium, and triangle is like a triangle. So these are the things that give you opportunity to make diagrams. So there are two things, you know, that you can make diagram about this in this question. So we have already put a lot of content. You can reduce some content and make, you know, add a diagram. So the diagram of the tools will be like this. So this is the cutting edge of the stone. This is the cutting edge of the stone. And triangles. Cutting edge of the stone. So write lunate, trapezium, and triangle. Niche mein figure. What is the figure about? It is about the Mesolithic tools. Okay, Mesolithic microliths. Put it inside a box. This is one, you know, diagram. Mesolithic tools. Okay. Another diagram that we can add in this is this. And diagram should be in between the answer, not at the beginning or the last. Another diagram that you can add is this. This is zero. Just make this part. No need to make more than this. Just make this part. So Israel will be somewhere here. Highlight this part. Natufian culture. Okay. And put it inside the box. Natufian culture. So it was located somewhere here. Okay. Or on the eastern coast of Mediterranean, where today's Israel and Palestine are located. Okay. Fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the kind of diagram. This is one diagram you can make. And the other diagram that I showed of tools. Very simple, not taking any time at all. With some little practice, you can make these world maps and India maps within seconds. Okay, guys?
Hello. Sir, it's a request. What I am talking about is about geography. But sir, if you can make just a 1 or 5 minute video of how to make a world map or the India map.
Definitely. I'll make a
video. That will be very helpful, sir.
Yes, I'll make a video, sir, regarding world map and India map, and I'll post it. Fine? Okay? Okay. So, now coming back to, you know, our stuff that we were have written down. So, you know, art, about their art and culture. There's an Ain Sakhri lovers bolke. There's a stone, you know, sculpture that is very, very popular. You know, it is said that this is the oldest known depiction of a couple making love. So it's like two stones, like a male and a female making love, found around 10,000 BC. So it is one of the oldest representations of, you know, a couple making love. And this art piece is very popular. So they have other art pieces also, but this art piece is very popular, and that's why I mentioned it here. What is the meaning of mortuary practices? Mortuary practices?
Burying of the dead body.
Burying or the burning or whatever. You know, the way the dead body is dealt with. The way people deal with their dead ones. That is called mortuary practice. It could be buried. It could be burnt or like cremated in us. Or it could be left in the open. For whom?
Parsis.
Which culture? Parsis. What are those places called where they do it? Where they leave the dead body?
Fire. The Ring of Fire.
No. Okay, Ring of Fire is a joke. Right? They have fire temple, yes, but that thing is called the Tower of Silence. Mm-hmm. Where they leave the dead bodies, they are called Towers of Silence. We have one in Calcutta, not very far off from my office. Okay, so, yeah, right. So, you should know about these different kind of practices. They are all very interesting. So, mortuary practices, the Natufian, they buried their people, and the grave goods, they were grave goods. You know, if you want to further, you know, add idea to this, in the bracket, you can type. Grave goods ka matlab kya hai? If there are grave goods, what does that mean?
The goods that are buried along with the dead body, is it?
Yeah, they are the grave goods. But if you find grave goods in any culture, it means that that culture believes in afterlife.
Free birth. Okay, afterlife. Okay.
Right? Whenever you find grave goods, things buried with the grave in any culture, it means that those people believe that some stuff will be required in the next phase of the next life. Okay? So they have a belief in afterlife, and that's why they bury all those things with their, you know, loved ones. So you can put that, you know, small belief in afterlife. So they are typically, you know, made of shell, teeth, and all those stuff are there, because gold and silver, that is, you know, very, very recent. You know, those things were not important for them. Okay. Two popular finds, like I have mentioned, a popular, you know, art piece. Similarly, I have, you know, mentioned two popular, you know, burials. One is the Natufian shaman woman. What is a shaman? S-H-A-M-A-N. Shaman or shaman?
Having some magical powers.
Yes, someone who performs, you know, the healing, basically magical healing and all in some cultures. We'll study this, you know, in our magic, religion and science chapter. It is there. So, shaman. So, it is assumed that, you know, this lady that is buried is a shaman. You know, because she was surrounded with a lot of things that seemed like suggesting black magic or something. And then there is a, you know, burial of a man with a dog. So, these are some important ones. Conclusion, you can write, you know, that this is one of the most significant sites of, you know, ancient, you know, cultures that you can use a word that is called incipient. Incipient. Stage of incipient agriculture. Stage of incipient. Incipient matlab agriculture is about to start. This is a stage of incipient agriculture. This phrase you can use. And yes. And which period this belongs to? This belongs to Mesolithic period. Mesolithic. And the Mesolithic is called Epipaleolithic as far as that part of the world. In the Middle East, Mesolithic is called Epipaleolithic. So you can write Epipaleolithic slash Mesolithic. This is part of Mesolithic. Very important. So that is about the Natufian culture. It's already 9. Okay. Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. Even this was there. I would say that these questions, you know, for someone who has, you know, not studied anthropology properly, these questions were a little difficult. A little difficult. If someone has not studied anthropology with a lot of love and interest, if just, you know, studied for the sake of, you know, passing the exam, they would have found, you know, some questions difficult. So Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, very important for those who love, you know, to think about how language would have evolved, what role language plays, what big an invention language is for our culture. Without language, we would not be what we are today. So Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is about that. It seems to be a very short answer. No, but if you look at the word count, it is around 190 words. 191 words. So, isme bhi, you know, you'll have to make it shorter. But remember, trust me, Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, they cannot ask a 15 or 20 marker on this. This is a little difficult concept, or not too much to write about this concept. So, it will either be a 10 marker or it will be part of some other question, whether they will talk about, you know, other things regarding language. In that, a small part can be Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. So basically, Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is nothing but I was discussing with a student yesterday who is in our first batch of answer writing. So we all know that culture influences language. Culture influences language. So for example, if my culture, if I'm belonging to the Rig Vedic culture, what was the Rig Vedic economy like? What were things important in the Rig Veda? Guys, do you have any other class after this? Anyone? I don't think anyone has any class after this. Anyone has any class after this? No? Oh, fine. So, I want to take a small opinion poll. Till what time should we continue?
9:30.
Okay, theek hai, 9:30. So, we will not be able to finish, you know, the other three questions. We'll have to do the next day. Because today I did a lot of other things also about how to start answer writing. So,
we can keep one more session. I think that will
be useful. So not just one more session, you know, I have planned of having at least one session every week. Okay.
Sir.
I planned of having at least one session of this discussion of answer writing.
There is a it's just a suggestion, like before taking any session, if you can mention that what's going to happen. Like even if we get these questions beforehand, okay. So maybe we can write it and can see the model answer.
Very good, very good. So what I will do is, you know, I had mentioned that it will be previous year's questions, but I had not mentioned which question. So you want me to mention the questions as well, right?
Yes, sir. Question or the section?
Yeah, fine. That will be good. You know, so there will be two-way communication. So I will let you know the exact questions which we are going to discuss. Okay. That will make it better. You will also have, you know, have a lot of opinion about it now. Fine. So, Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. So, you know, we all know that culture influences language because language is a small part of culture. So, jaisa culture hoga, language vaisa hoga. So, you know, it's something like this, you know. Sometimes, you know, some Hindi words are coming out. So I believe if anyone doesn't understand Hindi, please let me know. Okay. I try to be only English so that everyone can follow, but sometimes it comes out. Okay. So we all know that culture influences language because, you know, culture is everything that is man-made. Language is a part of it. Culture is a bigger thing, you know, and language is a subset. This is culture and this is language. Language is a smaller set of culture. So culture is a big thing and it influences language. We all know that. One example is Rig Vedic. So can anyone tell me what was the Rig Vedic economy like? Rig Vedic economy?
So it's almost subsistence farming. Matlab ke liye
pastoral
farming karenge.
Pastoral.
Okay.
Who said pastoral? No, it was not agriculture. Who said pastoral?
Me, sir. Sai.
Good, Sai. It was pastoral, okay? So it was pastoral. Agriculture was not important. People did grow barley, but very less extent. And because, you know, how do we know that? Because in those the text of those times, the Rig Veda, very few words for grains. And the most common word, gau, which means?
Cow.
So gau is not the word that is used all by itself all the time. Sometimes, you know, there are a lot of words that come out of it. So, you know, godhuli. What is the meaning of godhuli? Those who know Hindi, godhuli.
Dhan jo gai ke karan hota hai.
Godhuli.
Evening.
Evening time.
Is the dusk time. Okay. Dusk time. So I feel that why it was named Godhuli, because in the dusk, the cows are returning, you know, after grazing out, they're returning. So, you know, the dust is rising from their feet. Because I've seen these kind of things in the village. You know, when cows return in the evening, it becomes very dusty. Everyone's cows are returning at the same time in the village. Entering the village, dust keeps on flying. So maybe, you know, that time is called Godhuli because of that. So Godhuli is one example. I'm not able to recall, you know, because I left history. It used to be my optional. Now it is not. So I left it many years back. So there are many, many words I'm not able to recall which have a part of the word go, gau. Okay, showing the importance of cow. So the culture is pastoral culture, importance of cow reflected in the language. Language has words full of, you know, cow. Culture is not regarding, you know, so things are, you know, reflected. Culture is reflected in the language. Culture impacts language. This everyone knows. Sapir-Whorf said something else. They said other way around. Language also influences culture. Because I speak certain language, my culture will become like that. It's a very, you know, idea that has a lot of people are not able to accept. How is that possible? And they've also given some examples. But the, you know, it could, because, you know, language is something that is, you know, intangible. It cannot be tested and tried in the lab. You cannot take an experiment. You know, in a test, if you take one language, you mix with other language, you do not have empirical things that you can observe and note down and take readings about language. That doesn't happen. It's intangible. So proving things is difficult. And that's why this Sapir-Whorf hypothesis has not been proven. But what they said is like this. They gave an example. There's a tribe called Hopi. Hopi tribe in USA. They are basically American Indian tribes. So indigenous American tribes. This Hopi tribe, according to Sapir-Whorf, they said that, you know, their language, in their language, like in English, if you compare to English has this, you know, expressions for past. Something is gone. He died. He's dying. He will die. The grammar tenses. Part and the tense part and everything, you know, gives an indication of past, present and future. You know, gives an indication of the time having a component that is gone will not come back. Time having a component that is still there and time having a component that is about to come. So time having different sections and segments, you know, something that is gone and all those things, past, present and future. That is reflected in our English language. But the Hopi language has no indication of any past, present, future. No indication of things that are, you know, they talk about everything in the same way. Whether they have done it, they are doing it, or they will do it. They use the same kind of words, same kind of grammar and stuff. So they said that because their language is like this, that is why their culture is also like this. Their culture also, they do not, you know, have, you know, anything, you know, that is associated with past, present, future. So there will not be any activity, you know, for every activity they talk in the sense as it is still going ongoing. They never say that I've already done this. You know, whenever you ask what is going on in your village, they will always say that this is happening, this is happening, this is happening. They will never say this is done. You know, for them, it's like all the activities are always happening. In their culture, everything is always happening. And also they are sedentary. They keep on moving. They do not settle at one place. They keep on moving, continuously going, continuous. So what they suggested, it is because of their language that their culture has become like this. And I would say, I could still say that it is because of the culture that the language is like that. But they said, no, it is because of the language that the culture is like that. So it's like, you know, which came first, the egg or the hen, that kind of a debate. But yes, this is what Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is, not been proven yet. Okay. I have given around 190 words of answer, which if you want, you can use or you can modify. If the question comes again, fine. I think we can do one more. Okay. So I will do this one. C, human rights and cultural relativism. I have not written down anything for this. It is very simple. I'll explain. Human rights and cultural relativism. So first of all, I would want to know, Priyanshi, you tell me. Priyanshi, what do you mean by cultural relativism?
Sir, cultural relativism means, what I can recall right now is, that in different culture, the meaning of the same object can differ. Practical example is, like in India, if somebody, a boy stare to the girl, so it is considered inappropriate. But yes. Maybe if you go to some other country, so that is not, that is very normal. Like gazing and staring.
Yes.
So
You are right. We cannot judge every culture by our own standard. If it is bad in our culture, doesn't mean it's bad in every culture. You know, if you have read the Kerala State book for, which I suggest everyone should read, if you are starting off anthropology, if you're not already a student of anthropology for quite some time, just starting off, I would suggest read the Kerala State Board books of class 11, 12. They have given a lot of examples, like, you know, suddenly, you know, now the foreigners know a lot about us, but initially when they saw people sitting down and eating with their hands, the thing will be, I mean, are they so poor? I mean, they don't have money to buy a dining table. They don't have money to buy a spoon and fork. Shit, how they're eating with their hands. Poor fellows. Okay. So, because in their culture, anyone who is not having, you know, a dining table and having knife and fork is considered to be poor. He doesn't have, you know, so for them, you know, but here, you know, even the kings eat like that. Kings used to eat like that. So, you know, in Japanese, in us, you know, in our culture, you know, when we enter a temple or, you know, any sacred place, we, you know, take off our shoes. But that is not there in the Western cultures. You know, church ke bahar, you know, they don't have to take off their shoes outside the church. So things are relative. You know, every culture is not the same, and you have to look at a culture from their point of view, not your point of view. I will not go too deep into this because, you know, cultural relativism itself will be, you know, 2-3 classes. It's such a important topic. Now the next question is, who gave the concept of cultural relativism in anthropology? Who gave it?
Franz Boas.
Franz Boas belongs to which country?
Initially from Germany, then he moved to America.
Who was this? Who is giving this answer?
JJ,
very nice. Very good. JJ, you have been, doing good studies. I mean, you know, just not knowing what Boas told, but also knowing what Boas did in his life. Understanding our characters. This anthropology is our movie. And these characters are our, you know, heroes and heroines and villains. If you take interest in Boas, if you take interest in Margaret Mead, Malinowski, you know, Tyler, if you take interest and, you know, love these characters, and anthropology would be a cakewalk. You know, so very good. Yeah, he was a German guy. He himself faced a kind of, you know, racism in Germany because he was a Jew. So he himself, you know, faced anti-Semitism. He faced anti-Semitism, which is a anti-Jewish feeling in many European countries. Why that feeling is there, we'll discuss someday. very interesting thing. Why Hitler killed many Jews, but Hitler was not the first one. In fact, Hitler was one of the latest ones to hate the Jews. The hatred of Jews is very ancient. The Russians have always hated Jews. You know, the Russian monarchs many, many centuries before Hitler killed more Jews than Hitler would have killed. You know, a lot of people have killed Jews in a lot of places. Why that thing is there? Why Jews are hated? Why this anti-Semitism thing is there? That also we can discuss someday, but not today. Curiosity kills the cat and it will kill our time, but I will do, you know, so, because, you know, I believe, you know, in my classes it often happens. I tell you that I will take a 1.5 hour class, it becomes 2 hours. If I say 2 hours, it becomes 2.5 hours, because I digress a lot. But what I have observed is that this digression helps the students, because UPSC is not, you know, limiting yourself to those, you know, those A4 sheets of the book and the thing. You know, whatever knowledge from wherever you get helps you either in the prelims or mains or somewhere. Kahin na kahin, it helps. Yeah. So this anti-Semitism, it is a feeling because of, you know, anyone knows about it? Can anyone enlighten why this anti-Jewish feeling is there or has been there for so long? Now the anti-Jewish feeling is for a different reason altogether. Now it is the Islamic world is against the Jews because of the Israel-Palestine thing. But it was not always like this. It was actually the Christians who were after the, you know, life of the Jews. And the most Orthodox Christian countries, like, you know, the Orthodox Russian church, Russia was very Orthodox. They were after the Jews like anything, way before, you know, Hitler did anything.
I think it may be because some people worship the mother of Christ and some people worship the Christ. Is it because of that?
No, that is, you know, their own, you know, within that is that those are divisions between the Christianity itself. But you have to understand the Jews are a different religion and the Christians are a different religion. Why do they have this hatred? Is for this. You know, Jesus Christ, when he suddenly appeared, you know, he was himself a Jew, first of all. Does everyone know that? Jesus Christ was a Jew. Okay. So Judaism or Judaism is one of the oldest religions. Hinduism or the Brahmanism was in India much before Judaism, but then second oldest after, you know, our, out of the major religions, you know, because we don't know, many tribal religions may be older than us. So we should not insult them. Maybe they are older than us. Out of the major world religions, Hinduism is the oldest. Second oldest is the Judaism, way before, many, many, many centuries before Jesus Christ, around 3,000 years before Christ, Judaism has been there. So he himself was a Jew, Jesus Christ, but he was unhappy with, you know, so you have seen this, read about this Akali movement in history?
Yes, sir.
Read about, you know, this guy. Luther, Martin Luther.
Yes, sir.
Not Martin Luther King Jr. Martin Luther. What did Martin Luther do? Someone said, yes, sir. What did Martin Luther do? In Christianity, Martin Luther went against the church. He saw the church had become very corrupt. He saw that the Christian church has become very corrupt. Similarly, Akali movement, you know, the word that is mentioned in the books, Udasi Mahant. Guys, you guys are not reading history or what? History koi nahi pad raha, no one is reading history.
Bahut kharab hai sir history, uske karan hi main bahar hua.
History has to be very good. You know, it has to be very good for prelims and mains both. So Udasi Mahants were the, you know, the corrupt priests of the, you know, the Gurudwaras who were pro-British and anti-freedom movement, and they were, you know, kind of very corrupt. So Akali movement started against these corrupt, you know, priests. Martin Luther protested against the corrupt Roman Catholic Church and he found out the Protestantism. Similarly, Jesus, he was a Jew and he protested against the corrupt Jew priests, the big Jew priests who were very corrupt. He was protesting against them. He kept on abusing them, telling them, like, these guys are, you know, looting people. These guys are, you know, doing a sin and all those things. And these people did not like it. He wanted to get, you know, Jesus out of their way. So, you know, what happened is, now, us time pe, this region, today's Israel, was neither under Jews neither under Christians nor under Christians. It was under the Romans, and it was under the Romans based in Italy. So Romans. So around the time of Jews, what religion did the Romans follow? Around the time of Jesus, what religion did the Romans follow? Any idea? Romans were polytheists like we are today. They worshipped many gods, sun god and all gods. Just the way we do in Hinduism, Romans, that is today's Italy and, you know, the Rome part, that became Christian much, much, much later. They were neither Jews nor Christians. You know, Christianity to start bhi nahi hua tha. Christianity had not even started around that time because Jesus was there, you know, on the roads. And, you know, the Romans were pagan. You know, they did not believe in either of the religion. But the Romans ruled this place. Romans were the kings of this place. And the kings, you know, have to be, you know, hand in gloves with the important people like the priests, like the British. The British, you know, were always, you know, behind, you know, and always supported the Udasi Mahants. These corrupt priests, the corrupt priests of the Gurudwaras, they helped the rulers, the British, because, you know, it served their interest. Similarly, these corrupt Jew priests, they were always in favor of the Roman monarch because, you know, that, you know, gave them their position and everything. So the Roman monarch was also not happy about, you know, Jesus Christ, you know, creating law and order situations, and the Jews also wanted him out of his way. So, you know, one day Jesus was captured and he was tried, and it was basically the Roman general of the place called Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate actually wanted to get him killed, but Pontius Pilate played a game. He did not order, you know, that kill Jesus. He asked the priest, "You guys, what do you want? What should we do? What should I do with him?" They said, "You know, kill him. Again asked, "Tell me, what should I do with Jesus? They're saying, kill him. So he ordered for Jesus to be killed. But these Jews who were saying, kill him, they became the villains in Christianity. All the books that are written, all the Christian books that are written after that, they keep on saying that it is the Jews because of whom the Romans killed Jesus. And that's why the Orthodox Christian countries have always hated Jews. Now that thing is not there. Now the Christian and versus Jews thing is not there. But it was there because of this. And that is why even before Hitler, you know, the Russians killed Jews. And Hitler just said, you know, that these guys have not just betrayed Jesus. These guys have also betrayed us as a country, Germany as a country and all those things. So this is where anti-Semitism comes from. Okay, clear?
Yes, sir.
Clear? Who had asked the question? Who was this curious cat?
JJ, sir.
JJ, okay. Yeah, so this is, you know, the theory about... now, quickly going into cultural relativism and human rights. The question is cultural relativism and human right. Can anyone tell me why? Why cultural relativism and human right? These phrases are mentioned in the same, you know...
Sir, yeah. Because we can explain it through an example.
Yes.
For example, like in Germany... They wear good dresses and their living standard is high. But same in South Africa, in Sahara Desert, they don't even wear clothes because water is not available. So what happens when, what you said, white man burden. Mm-hmm. This is a theory of white man burden. When wherever they go, they keep them as a lower part. See, that we are here to teach you. And this leads to human right violation.
Okay.
Sir, it may be another way around as well.
Yes, tell me.
In Bora community, we know about genital mutilation.
This is actually the example I was looking for. Suraj.
Yes, sir.
Suraj, listen to the example Priyansi is saying. Yes, Priyansi, tell me.
So, sir, if we say, okay, we respect all the things of a culture, and if we promote even that, that mutilation thing, so, sir, then that is the violation of the human right. So, whatever is happening in a culture, maybe everything is not right. So, in that respect, that question has come, I think.
Very good. Sabarimalai, you know, you say that women cannot enter. Okay, that is part of our culture. You know, there are so many examples full of, you know, there are a lot of examples where you know, you can say that this is not part of our culture. For example, you know, men can have, you know, can do polygamy, but women cannot in a culture, you know, because this is part of our culture. So now say for ISIS, the Islamic State, what they're doing is they are, you know, just simply, you know, making video while slitting the throat of people. You know, they can say this is part of our culture. Who are you to finger question? You know, have some, so you know, someone says, brother, ISIS, don't kill someone. They are saying, no, this is part of our culture. Man, what are you doing? Be cultural relativist. Support what, you know, I mean, you know, you should respect whatever our culture is. So that is the thing. So till what extent can we go on support, you know, ignoring everything, saying, you know, this is part of their culture, let it be. We should not poke our fingers in this. This is part of their culture, let it be. You know, we should not poke fingers in this. You know, for example, the tribals who used to do the, you know, human sacrifice.
Headhunters.
Yeah. So headhunting in your
Northeast
Naga tribes. Yeah. And you know, Konyak Nagas, yes. And then also, you know, this which was this British guy here, Lord, I'm forgetting the name, who had stopped, you know, or who had banned the human sacrifices among the tribes in Central India. A lot of Central Indian tribes. Hyman.
Verrier Elvin
was an anthropologist. Verrier Elvin is an anthropologist. Like William Bentinck stopped the Sati, you know, thing. Similarly, there was a governor general who stopped human sacrifice. He was also the only governor general to be killed in office when he went to Andaman. Lord Harding. So Lord Harding was the one, you know, who was also killed, you know, but Lord Harding had stopped this human sacrifice. So, you know, the tribals could say, you know, that this is our culture, man. You know, just keep your hands off. You know, be cultural relativist. Haven't you read Boaz? Let us do whatever we want to do. This is part of our culture. So, till what extent can we allow every cultural practice, just, you know, keeping our eyes closed because it is, you know, cultural relativism, part of their culture. Let's not put our, you know, let's not question it. Kahan tak? Till what extent? This is the question. That when the cultural practices, you know, are going against human rights, what is to be done? Okay, this is the thing. So in the answer, first you have to explain what is cultural relativism. You have to explain whose concept it is. Franz Boas's historical particularist school of thought, you know, where he talks about what is cultural and why cultural. He says that every culture has its own particular history. You know, if they are at some place, if they are at today's what they are, it is because of their history. And since every culture has its own separate history, that's why every culture is different. And we should not compare, and we should not, you know, question, you know, that this is good or bad. So Boas, you can mention in the answer. And then you can give some good examples, you know, that cultural relativism brings about, you know, this kind of, what you say, tolerance and all those, you know, kind of things. But then you can go in the second part that, you know, but there are a lot of practices which are cultural practices, but they are against human rights. And you can give some examples. Okay. And there you must not forget mentioning this lady. She wrote a book called Cultural Relativism and the, I think it was Violation. Let me see. Cultural Relativism and, I forgot. It's a book, you will just search in Google or you'll get it. Elizabeth Zakenter wrote a book that Cultural Relativism and the Violation of Individual Rights or something like that. So she wrote a book, you have to mention her, that Elizabeth Zakenter says that, you know, in this book, she says that till what extent should we, you know, we close our eyes on human right violating activities in the name of cultural relativism. There has to be a balance. Okay? So that should be your conclusion, that there has to be balance. You know, cultural practices, we should not judge cultural practices. We should not place them on a grade of superior, inferior and those things. But then, you know, with individual rights also becoming important, you know, there has to be a balance so that cultural practices do not violate individual rights, you know, and you can give some example from India, like, you know, the Khap Panchayats of Haryana, they can say, you know, that, you know, we will get honor killing done because this guy and this girl has married outside their caste. So we have to kill them. This is part of our culture. This is against our honor, so we'll do that. So should we allow that or should we not allow that? Definitely should allow that. So, you know, you have to, you know, given the conclusion that culture is also important, but human rights are also important. And so, you know, none of them has to be given a higher pedestal. Both of them have to be treated case to case basis. Okay. It is very similar to your polity thing of fundamental rights and directive principles. There's a tussle between them. Okay. And then in a Supreme Court case, the case said that they are like the two wheels of the same chariot. What is the name of the case where the Supreme Court said that, you know, they none is higher or lower. Both of them are, you know, two wheels.
Minerva Hills case.
Great, guys. You're doing good in polity. Awesome. So similar to that, you know, Minerva Mills cannot be mentioned here. Similar to that, you have to give a kind of balancing and conclusion that, you know, they are like the two wheels of an individual's existence. And that's why a balance has to be struck. Okay. Got it?
So we can also say that ethnocentrism and cultural relativism, these are just the methods of doing the research. So in that case, we should not relate the human right and the cultural relativism.
They're just the methods of doing research. Okay. So
because they are just approaches for research.
Okay. So, okay. Right. So I'm getting it, you know. So, you know, cultural relativism and cultural ethnocentrism, these are ideal, you know, concepts that are, you know, the ideals. But in real life, you know, we should not go by those. And real life, you have to see the situation and decide. That is what you try to say.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, right. That is also, you know, they're ideals. They're the things that are there in the books. But in real life, how much they are practicable, that depends on the ground situation. Yes. Possible. That can also be given. Okay. But make sure you have examples. First thing, make sure your examples that are geographically diversified. I have given all the examples of India only. Give some more examples. You know, female genital mutilation is very common in African tribes. Okay. So you can give some African examples. You can give some examples of say,
think of examples.
Kalgari movement in Jharkhand.
Black Lives Matter.
Yes, sir.
Black Lives Matter, you know, you can give that example of Black Lives Matter that, you know, so
the Pathalgadi movement in Jharkhand.
Pathalgadi movement, yes, very nice. Pathalgadi movement going on in Jharkhand, the tribal movement. Pathalgadi movement is extremely important. Read it. It will be helpful in paper one, paper two, essay everywhere. Also, it will be helpful in your GS paper three, internal security. If the movement is not controlled, it will go and become something like Naxalbadi.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Anything else, guys?
Sir, second question, जो linguistic language वाला था, sir, उसको कैसे interpret करें? मतलब अब तो ये आ गया तो हम लोग कर ले रहे, but future में मतलब
because it is not outside your syllabus. If you read your syllabus, you know, properly, if you read the syllabus, if you read the standard books that are there, for example, if you read the language part from a standard book, you know, Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is mentioned somewhere or the other. You will find it. You have to find it. Okay. Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is not something outside the syllabus. It was mentioned in the syllabus. Okay. So Sapir-Whorf hypothesis and all the five questions that are there, you know, I had gone through them because while teaching, I had read all those things. Okay. As a student, yes, I had not read these things, but you have to expand your scope and, you know, whatever. So you are reading a chapter in your book and you get this phrase, you know, that Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. It is your duty to Google it and know something about it at least. Okay.
Sir, what's this fifth question mein jo hai, experiential ethnography?
Achha, experiential ethnography. So, you know, experiential ethnography, if you have, you know, have you finished all the theory and all the theories that are
yes,
there
sir.
In the syllabus? Yes, postmodernism.
Yes sir. Yes, sir.
Everyone has his own experience.
Yes.
You know, and so earlier it was, you know, that my point of view is right. My point of view is right. My point of view is right. Okay, mine is right. His is wrong. Those kind of things. But now after postmodernism, there is no one single interpretation. Everyone, you know, everyone's interpretation can be right. Everyone's interpretation can be wrong. You know, it's no more an interpretation. It's no more a clear-cut, you know, decision that. So a researcher is studying researcher studying and saying that I found out these things. They are not a clear cut, you know, decision made about that culture. They are just that scholar's experience. He experienced that. Someone else may come and experience something else. Someone else may come and experience something else. Have you read about something called
inner views and outer views? That name?
No, emicetic is fine. No, emicetic is also some part of it. There was a guy, you read about it, okay? Who asked me this question about experience?
JJ.
Yeah. JJ. So read about this guy, okay? Do some YouTube about this guy.
Foucault.
Name?
Carlos Castaneda. Carlos Casta, C-A. Okay. It is, or look, either Carlos Castaneda or Castinada or something like that. If you type this Carlos Casta, it will come. Carlos Castaneda. There are some YouTube videos about him, about experiencing ethnography. Okay. He's a very interesting character. Read about him. And yeah, Michel Foucault, definitely yes. Michel Foucault is important because he is one of the main scholars that we have in postmodernism. But read about this guy, Carlos Castaneda. Okay.
So this is Michel Foucault, F-U-C-U.
No, no, it's F, exact
F-O-U-C-A-U-L-T.
Something like that. Michel Foucault. So Michel Foucault. Okay. You tell me, Suraj, what may be the gender of Michel Foucault? So Michel name is usually for females, but this guy is a guy. But this is a guy. Okay. Okay. He's a French. So in French, you know, you can definitely not take any word for granted. It sounds like whatever something else and it is actually something else. So he's a French guy. He's also a very interesting guy. So as I said, love the characters. So Michel Foucault, don't just read about his theory. See one YouTube video about his life. He had a very troubled life and that reflected in his theories. Michel Foucault.
Sir, ye Carlos Castaneda postmodernist hai kya?
Yes. Actually, now he's not considered as an anthropologist.
Achha.
He has been rejected and kicked out as a fraud.
Why, sir?
That is for you to, you know, experiential ethnography.
So,
okay. You sir, have to experience this by...
Hopi tribe ke bare mein bataya. So, like, I understood about the language part, but then how it's affecting their culture? What is there in their culture?
Yeah. So, he said that because their language, you know, because their language has no differentiation of what is already over, what is happening and what is to happen. Their culture is also like that. For them, everything is always happening. You talk about, you know, things that have become over also, for them also, they will say, ki chal raha hai, it's happening. They don't, talking to them, you know, these two scholars, Sapir and Hoff, realized that these people in their culture, there's nothing, no concept of things that are gone by. In their culture, everything is happening. And they even said this, that, you know, these people are, you know, always migrating. They are pastoral. They keep on migrating all the time. Never settle at a place. Always ongoing. Even this is because of their language. That is what they said.
Okay, sir.
But it was proven incorrect. I've written that and I'll share the file. It was proven, you know, later in some researches that, you know, in fact, their language has a lot of words for time, past, present, future. So this theory is actually was proven wrong. Basically proven wrong. It is not a theory that has been proven correct.
So, but we can see some incidents of the same in South India, like traditional people. So, sir, aisa hai ki aise mante hain jo bahut purane log hote hain ki koi bhi cheez jaise khatam ho jati hai ghar mein.
Is everyone in the class understand Hindi? Everyone in the class?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Anyone who doesn't understand Hindi? Fine. Yeah. Because, you know, I want ki no one should miss out anything.
I can speak in English also, not English.
But everyone said they are fine with Hindi. Toh, because then I can also, maybe in Hindi, I can talk about which is
okay, sir.
Yeah.
So, sir, I was saying that like South India, mein, especially as I have seen it, and वैसे भी North, mein bhi jo, traditional people, there is a concept that just like कोई चीज जैसे घर पे खत्म हो गई या कोई भी negative concept अगर है, like कोई जा रहा है. So they will never say ki ye cheez khatam ho gaya. They will say okay, ki
Bengali,
kam ho gaya.
In Bengali also. In Bengali, we never say ki ami jachi, main ja raha. They never say. When I'm leaving home for office, I would say aschi, main aata hu. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Khudiram Bose, you know, when he was about to be hanged, he told his mother that fire asbo, fire aschi, I'll come back. a very emotional thing. But yes, but you know, this actually doesn't relate to, it is not an example of this thing. You know, what they were saying is, because the language is like that, the culture has become like that. But here you can say, because our culture is like that, you know, we don't want, you know, anything to end. We don't want people to die. We don't want to lose our dear ones. That's why we have made our language like that.
Okay, sir.
That is the difference. Culture impacting language or language impacting culture. Culture impacting language, many examples, common thing that we see everywhere. But language impacting culture, that is what they said. Language is dictating what the culture will be like. Okay.
Got it.
Okay. Guys, so we could discuss only three questions. You know, what we have to do is, you know, this took more than 1.5 hours. So after this, you know, we'll try to be a little faster so that, you know, every week we have a session and we try to cover at least 5 questions in every class. We'll have to try to cover more questions in every class. You know? So we'll do that. And I'll share the question from beforehand from the next time. Okay.
Also, okay, sir, please share the PDF of today.
Yeah, PDF. Yeah, that was a Word file. I'll make it a PDF and share. Yes, but, you know, that contains answer of only 2 questions. So I'll share that only. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Whatever answer it contains. Okay. Theek hai. Guys, anything else?
No, sir.
Okay, okay. And anyone here who is part of 2021, appearing in 2021, anyone?
Yes, sir. I am appearing. JJ.
JJ, have you joined a Telegram group that has been made only for 21 guys?
Yes, sir. Today only I came to know about it. I joined it today.
Okay, yeah. You join it. Okay, see. We have a program for people who are appearing in 2021. We'll be giving you two full length test, one full paper one, full paper two. You write the test, you know, the question. So the date is like, I think, 4th December and something like that. I have shared it in the Telegram group. So one full paper one, one full paper two, two tests, which will be evaluated, one-on-one feedback given. And then the routine is out. So you have exam on 9th and then you have exam on 15th. As it always happens, there is gap. 9th ko you have GS papers, last GS paper, then 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 is off. 15 is your language paper. Basically, you don't need to study. So basically 6 days gap after, you know, and after that, there is anthropology option. So just before your mains exam, I'll give you 2 more papers, one full paper one, one full paper two. In those 5 days, 6 days gap, you solve one full paper one, one full paper two, and I will evaluate. Okay.
Okay, sir. Sir, can we take one more question?
Suraj. Yeah.
Sir, JJ. Sir, is baar jo question aaya tha, ye how have interpretation and presentation of data has changed from classical to contemporary writings? तो सर इसमें मतलब जो मुझे दिमाग में आ रहा था वो मैं आपको पहले शेयर कर देती हूँ, देन सर आप थोड़ा अपने इनपुट्स दे दीजिएगा.
ठीक है. इनफैक्ट आई माई सेल्फ डोंट हैव अ लॉट ऑफ इनपुट्स अबाउट इट, यू नो देयर आई हैव, थोड़ा सा मुझे ये क्वेश्चन देखना पड़ेगा, मैंने क्वेश्चन पेपर पर देखा नहीं है. एंड
सर व्हाट,
टेल मी व्हाट इज कमिंग टू योर माइंड राइट.
व्हाट सर, मैं इस तरह सोच रही थी कि इनिशियली वी स्टार्टेड फ्रॉम सेकेंडरी डेटा, सेकेंडरी डेटा.
यस, देन वेरी मच.
Then slowly we move to primary data brought by Malinowski, and then positivist approach by R.C. Brown.
Yes,
and
yes,
then
very
slowly,
much.
Then slowly we move to non-positivist or phenomenology. ये structuralist जो हैं, मतलब individualistic जो cultural personalities school है, they used third tertiary or quaternary data.
Yes,
also.
Yes. So, this is really good. I mean, yeah, you already have the answer. You already have the answer. I'm sure that a lot of people would not have, you know, thought of all this in the exam hall. If you can think of and write this answer, you would have definitely got good marks, very good marks. Yes.
Sir, इसमें एमिक और एटिक को भी तो जोड़ सकते हैं. पहले तो
what is the question? Data interpretation and representation. What is it? Data?
Emic.
No. Question was regarding data representation and
how have interpretation and presentation of data.
Okay, so interpretation part is also there. Yes, so emicetic can also come, you know, interpretation, you know, whether are you interpreting it from the outsider point of view, or are you interpreting it from someone who belongs to the culture? The interpretation part is also coming there. Yes, very much. Interpretation, when interpretation comes, you have a school, the interpretive school, or this, you know, the Victor Turner, interpretative and symbolic school, Victor Turner and Clifford Geertz. Yeah. So they are, you know, this so they have kept on saying about interpretation, especially Clifford Geertz is extremely important. He keeps on saying that what I studied was just my interpretation. It is not a final word on the culture. Someone else will read, he have his own interpretation. Everyone will have their own interpretation. Everyone's interpretation, you know, no one's interpretation is wrong or right or complete or incomplete. So, you know, this is also one,
so, sir,
you know,
this also symbolic example of experiential ethnography.
Yes, very much, very much. This is also, you know, what one is experiencing, and that varies from person to person. And that is why, you know, and, you know, so experiential, you know, ethnography, there can be a lot of examples. Even I can go as back as the culture personality school. During the time of culture personality school, what happened is Margaret Mead went to the field. She experienced something and she wrote a book and she became popular. Someone later went and he experienced totally different in the same society. Margaret Mead found the society to be, you know, very open about, you know, physical relations, the girls to be, you know, totally independent. No patriarchy. The parents are very cool. They are, you know, okay with their teenager children, you know, having, you know, a physical relationship and all those things. And no hold of Christianity, you know, all those things are there. Just a couple of decades or one decade later, you know, another guy went. He was Australian guy. I'm not able to recall his name. And he found it to be totally opposite. He found it to be a very patriarchal society where, you know, chastity and virginity was kind of, you know, worshipped, and women or girls were not allowed to mingle with the boys, and the fathers were very, you know, strict, and, you know, kind of beating and all those things also happened, and Christianity has taken very strong roots. So he experienced a totally different thing. Okay. So this is also, you know, experiential ethnography.
Sir, what we have to do to get like above 150 in paper one?
Paper one, very simple. Paper one, you have to target physical anthropology. You must target physical anthropology, which is about the biology and the genetics part, which has a lot of scope of examples, diagrams, case study examples. Okay, you have to target that. Okay, and the fossil part. So physical anthropology, which includes your genetics part and the fossil part, because if you write well, there will be no scope of cutting your marks. If it tells you, you know, if the question says Homo erectus. If you, you know, give everything about erectus, you know, how the skull was and, you know, how it is different from his, you know, predecessor, what all changes were happening, his body, you know, he had the opposable thumbs and all those things, you know, he was erect, his culture was this, they had fire, they had burials, they had this, that, you know, make a map as to where Homo erectus have been found. If you do all that, which is there in the books, you know, where will the examiner cut your marks? So this physical anthropology part, which is ekdam cut to cut, whatever there is in the book will be asked, and you have to, no interpretation. There is no interpretation as this can be or that can be. No interpretation. That is very scoring. Do target that.
But sir, is baar to jyada nahi aaya.
Is baar sir, society se mila ke aaya hai.
So, you know, you have to, you know, yes, but
interrelate.
You have to try that, you know, physical anthropology questions should not be missed. That you have to try because they are very scoring. Now, a word that Suresh has said, interrelate, that is not just for paper one. That is for paper one, paper two, everything. You have to interrelate. You know, if a paper one question comes, you have to interrelate with paper two. If a paper two questions comes, you have to interrelate with paper one. Like, you know, the question in paper one comes about, say, you know, cultural materialism. You know, you can relate it to, you know, the study that, you know, my memory is really failing. What was the guy, you know, cultural materialism? Marvin Harris. Marvin Harris did, you know, on the number of male and female cows in UP and Kerala. And you can relate it to the communal things going on in India. So yeah. Communalism, which is part of paper two, can be linked with cultural materialism of paper one. Okay. If paper two, you know, your traditional Indian society about feminism and all those questions come about, you know, patriarchy and stuff. In paper one, Margaret Mead did some study in, you know, the three islands. Arapes, Mundugumar, and Chambuli, or something like that, the name was. You know, where she found out the gender roles and the, you know, are not same as the sex. The male guy is not like, you know, the one who's going out all the time. Mm-hmm. Some, you know, in some islands, the female is doing those things, and male is doing the home wala kaam, ghar wala kaam. So, you know, these show that, you know, patriarchy has no basis. It has no, you know, biological basis. It has a cultural basis. Culture has, you know, shown that the women are weak and they should not be going out and doing this. This is Margaret Mead's study in paper one, which can be used in paper two. So you have to link paper one, paper two.
ट्राइबल्स में मैक्सिमम मैट्रियार्कल सोसाइटी है प्रेजेंट, अगर इंडिया में देखा भी जाए तो
मैट्रियार्कल.
हां
ओके,
पैट्रियार्कल नहीं है ट्राइबल्स में, मतलब है मैक्सिमम.
ओके ओके, वन थिंग आई वांट टू टेल यू समथिंग, यू गाइस कैन नोट इट डाउन एंड चेक. Check the difference between matriarchal and matrilineal and matrilocal. Indian families are matrilineal. Some tribes, matrilineal, not matriarchal.
Yes, sir.
Matriarchy is totally different. In fact, in the world, there is today no true example of a single matriarchal society. There is no true example of a matriarchal society in the entire world today. Matrilineal, yes. But matriarchal, no.
Yes, matrilineal, I want to
say. Okay. So, there's only one tribe in China, Mosuo, which come close to matriarchy, but they're also not totally matriarchal. Okay, anything else?
Sir, Margaret Mead ka paper 2 mein kahan pe use kar sakte hain?
Margaret Mead, you know, see, you have a traditional Indian society.
Hmm.
Traditional Indian society mein you draw the Indian society and traditional thing, you know, that you know, the belief in the purusharths, patriarchy, joint family, those are different features of the Indian traditional system. उसमें जो पैट्रियार्की पार्ट है, पैट्रियार्की डजंट हैव अ साइंटिफिक और बायोलॉजिकल बेसिस, इट हैज अ कल्चरल बेसिस एज शोन बाय मार्गरेट मीड इन हर स्टडी इन द थ्री आइलैंड्स, यू नो वेयर इट्स अ जेंडर, यू नो, जेंडर असाइंड रोल, द असाइंड रोल्स दैट दिस गाय ही इज अ मेल सो ही विल गो आउट, इट इज नॉट बिकॉज द नेचर हैज मेड हिम लाइक दैट, इट इज बिकॉज द सोसाइटी डिसाइडेड दैट दिस ही विल गो आउट, एंड इट वाज सीन, यू नो, दैट इन दोज आइलैंड्स, दे आर नियर बाय आइलैंड्स, बट इन वन आइलैंड the males are, you know, very calm and, you know, chup-chap ghar mein baith ke, and the female are doing all the marketing and fighting and everything on the street. So, why?
Sir, actually,
because it is no scientific basis of male, you know, being the outside bread earner. Whatever role the society assigns, people take it up.
So, Margaret Mead hi point out ki thi ki ye actually isliye hota hai ki jab वुमेन्स को बच्चों का ख्याल रखना पड़ता है तो उनको घर में रुकना पड़ता है कुछ दिन के लिए.
Yes, so it was actually, yeah, right. So this, you know, when the infant is dependent on the mother, you know, so this is actually not exactly Margaret Mead. This is a very old theory that showed that this is why, you know, the you know, females lost out, you know, the females for a good, you know, 5-6 months, they would be out of all the action, you know, at home. So that's why the males utilize those periods and males became dominant. So we are going into a lot of other topics which we'll keep on discussing. So let's call it a day, okay? Because it was, I think the recording was for only 1.5 hours. I'm not sure if the entire thing has been recorded. One final question I'll take. Anyone, one final question?
Right,
no
now.
Question. Okay, so no question, fine. So next week we'll again have this kind of a session, but usme we'll not discuss either other ka things, we'll discuss only the 5 questions.
Okay,
so that
sir,
we can, you know, complete within time. Okay, fine. Thank and you. 2021 aspirant, please join the Telegram group if you have received. I think you have received an invite. I believe you have received an invite. If you have, please join. Okay, JJ.
Okay, sir.
JJ, do you have Rahul sir's number or Anindo sir's number?
No, sir.
Fine. So in case you are not able to, you know, join the 2021 aspirants group, please ping in the group, whichever group you are part of, that I'm not able to join, so that we can send you the invite.
Okay, sir.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, guys. Let me see if anyone has asked any question. Sir, can you share the recording of this session? Yes, I will share the recording of this session, and we'll also put it on the YouTube. Cattle herders. So, sir, can it be a little quick? How long session will run? JJ, I understand. Okay, yeah, JJ, even so, we'll keep this in mind that we have to finish the session quickly. We have to stick to time. Next class, say it will be 1.5 hour session, not more than that. Fine.
Sir, ek din pehle timing bata dijiyega na.
Yeah, fine. I'll inform in advance, one day in advance, and also the questions in advance.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Good night.
Good night, guys. Bye bye.